What's happening, YouTube fam? Today is a special broadcast for all those that want to know what is it like to try to make it in Hollywood. I've got a writer, director, and a minority and a sister at that that has done big things in Hollywood. She's going to let you know what it's like to try to break into the industry from the ground floor and really make an impact. All that starts right now under Lamont Tyson, Life Gains, TikTok, YouTube. It starts right now. I'm up early for the dealers come out. Everybody is outside till the killers come out. You ain't eating, you just act full. I'm impactful. Dozen funerals in a month. I got that full. I will give it to niggas in all rap forms. Ignatius out right now on all platforms. That's right, people. We in this building. Lamont Tyson, please subscribe to the channel, download the podcast, and joining me today is the fair sister. I should call her the whisperer of Hollywood. It's my sis, Tamieka Briscoe. How you doing, Tamieka?
I am great, brother. How you doing, Lamont?
I'm hanging tough. Glad to have you here. Glad to pick your brain. Have you inspired my audience who all love TV and movies, and they always want to know what is it like to try to be in the industry? So we'll dive on right into it. You've been working at this Hollywood thing for a little bit. What was it that got you inspired, or what was it that made you want to go into film?
Oh, great question. I'm so happy to be here. Thanks so much. I think it's something, at least in my experience, it's on the inside. Like, I've always felt that way. Even as a little girl, like, I would watch TV and movies. I would read books. I would just get lost in the world. It's like an escape, and I still very much feel that way to this day. But even as I was growing up and watching things like the Emmys and the BET Awards and the Oscars, I would have this overwhelming feeling of, I'm going to be there one day, or I belong there. So I could never just enjoy it like a regular fan, like my friends. I would just be like, don't you want to go? And they're like, no. It's just me? Oh, okay.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, this woman has produced, she's written, she's directed, she's assisted. She's done all the alphabets that you can do in Hollywood. Two of her projects, one she did a while ago called QT. She did a season one and a season two and another shot. And her recent big film she just did is Spawns. And yes, that is Darren Henson. A lot of y'all know him from Soul Food. And he did a major, major thing for this particular film. And we'll jump right on into it. What inspired you to do the QT series? And I do have a clip for you all to see it. But let's talk about what got her inspired to do that. So you did that as a web series, correct?
Yes, originally it was a web series. Literally, it was around this time, 2020, when everything just shut down like overnight. The pandemic was just came out of nowhere for most of us, and we didn't know what to do. So I'm a very spiritual woman, and I started feeling fearful about like this disease that was just so scary. Like, this is at the very, very onset of COVID. Like, we didn't know what it was, and the number of deaths were so huge compared to the number of cases. So it was just like, what is this? Where is it coming from? We were doing everything we can to try to stay safe. So I took some time, I unplugged, I went on a fast. And in that time, God gave me an idea to do a web series about dating in quarantine. And it's unbelievable, like, how it took off. Like, I mean, if I had another explanation as to how this thing started, I would certainly say it. But literally, I was scared. I went into prayer. And in that silence, you know, God opened up, like, this creativity for things. And then when I tell you, by that obedience, it has just opened up to more and more opportunities. Like, QT was something we did on our cell phones, our iPhones during the pandemic, and had the editor like piece it together like into a very cinematic story. And then from there, we did QT Second Shot. Once we did come out of quarantine, when we had cameras and a real crew and the same actors. And then that even bled over to what is now Spawns, which is so exciting.
Wow. So, ladies and gentlemen, you can see all her QT series. If you just check the video description link, it has links not only to her series, but it has links to her website in case you want to reach out to her and really maybe get a one-on-one and understand what it takes to get into Hollywood. It's got links to her IMDb. And the QT series is absolutely free. You can click on it and go to Tubi. It is right there waiting for you. But for those of you that want to see a little piece of it, you know your boy got you. I couldn't bring you here without showing a little teaser. Take a look at the beauty, the cinematography that was done from an iPhone, edited and made into a great web series. Take a look at this.
Yo, I can't believe this chick, bro.
Yo, this her. Let me meet you back. All right.
Why are you blowing up my phone? I was in the middle of a work meeting, Cordell.
I just got back in town. They turned off my power and my gas, Janelle.
Okay, what are you telling me for?
The people said you transferred it out of your name and into a different address last week.
Okay. I moved in with Princess over, 6 months ago? So you had ample amount of time to make your own arrangements. And I finally got my own place and just got everything transferred. So this is on you. And I know you're not calling me complaining when they charge me for your past due bill.
Bruh, you need to get that figure. You can't be traveling around the damn world and then come back home and ain't paid your light bill and about to be mad at her. What the hell is your problem, bruh?
That, he's quite a character.
He looked like he's supposed to be a baller. Got the Malcolm X hat on, LA Lakers jersey, and then you ain't paid your light bill. Mm. And then you. So, ladies and gentlemen, that is a snippet. It looks amazing. Like, was it hard for you to shoot that with iPhones? Because, like you said, this was the heat of the pandemic.
Yeah.
And you had to, you know, you had to do the quarantine issues. Yeah. You had to have the spacing. What was it like to shoot that with iPhones during the pandemic?
Oh yeah, it's incredible. You'll be blown away to know that we did it 100% remotely. So literally the actors had to set up their own camera, send the DP and I a test shot so that we can make sure it was framed right, their lighting was right. But it really stretched all of us as artists. Like, they had to become mini filmmakers, because it was truly a collaboration to make sure we could get that cinematic look. So it did take quite a while, but as we did 2 seasons of QT. So towards the end of the second season, it was like, we cut it down drastically. We would have little Zoom meetings. And before the editor, he was creating squares to make it look like a Zoom. And then we figured out probably several, way too many episodes in, that we could actually just record it from Zoom and just hide our own cameras. So we were just figuring it out as we went, and it was incredible. I look back at that and I can't believe it.
I can only imagine that having to be so creative, mm-hmm. on the spur and on the fly,
yeah.
kind of when you got back to being able to do it the normal way, kind of made it feel, I don't want to say easy, but it didn't feel as much of a challenge as it would normally feel when you've had to go through those kind of creative outlets to get this film done.
For sure. It was incredible because when we did QT Second Shot, firstly, we were able to go on Clubhouse and raise 40K in 40 days to even do QT Second Shot. So that was a lot of our first time even seeing each other. Like, just walking into, like, we'd been working together for 2 seasons of a show and had never physically been in the same room together. Because this all unfolded in real time in 2020 all the way to 2021 during a pandemic. So we literally followed the rules. We were never, like, the only time people were in the same room were because they were already in the same household.
Gotcha.
So it was really cool.
Wow. Again, ladies and gentlemen, if you ever thought about getting into Hollywood and you want to find that mentor, that paid mentor that can help you out, her website is down in the video description. Check her out. She helped get my boy Taylor Todd into film, got his reality show done. She was a spur for that. She's allowed me to executive produce Spawns with her and taught me a lot. So definitely, if you want to learn something, check out her website. She can definitely help you, which will bring me to Spawns. And again, thank you for allowing me to learn from you and work with that experience. Let's talk about what Spawns has spawned into now. You, from what I understand and what I read on IMDb, that film, is it true that it's going to Cannes?
It is going to Cannes next month. We are so excited. That is our official premiere. So this is like the first public place I've actually talked about it. Even the whole team doesn't know yet.
Let me explain, because some of my audience may not know the significance of Cannes. Yeah. So if you don't mind, let me explain. Please. So for those of you that don't know but love film but never have had a chance to understand the film festival circuits, you have these major film festivals around the world. Some of y'all might be familiar with Sundance because you saw me there last year, but Cannes is one in France that is huge. I mean, it is probably in the top five of the biggest film festivals, right with Sundance, South by Southwest, and some of the other ones. And her film is there. Having said that, now pick back up so the fans understand the gravity of why it's important to know your film is in Cannes.
Oh, it's huge, especially as Spawns is a predominantly Black film, just like QT was predominantly Black. It's huge, like it is incredible. And we are premiering under the Pavilion Afriques at Cannes, which is a portion of Cannes that is dedicated to highlighting Black creatives, Black artists, and with the intent of bringing more projects to the continent of Africa, which we really have to, like the significance of that culturally, as well as just our first time as a family, because my children are part of the project, so I'm super excited. And we just get to move together in this incredible opportunity to go to Europe together and to, you know, be a part of this prestigious film festival and do something for our culture. And that's incredible.
That's amazing. So tell the people what Spawns is all about. I know about the banking issues going on in Spawns, but tell the people what they can look forward to with the premiere of Spawns. What are people going to be saying about it? Give them a little insight about Spawns.
Okay, so Spawns is so incredible. I'm so thankful and blessed for the team, the amazing producers like yourself, who it took a lot of us, all hands on deck, to make that happen. And then things come up and we're still making it happen together. And then just this amazing cast of great actors who just came in and took the story to the next level. So Spawns is actually a spinoff of QT, but it's meant to serve as its own thing. Like, you should, even if you've never seen an episode of QT, you should be able to watch Spawns and appreciate it. But if you do watch QT and you enjoy it, you'll be very excited to see, like, that many of those characters, how they have fit into this feature film version. But it's basically about the Banks family, who is a Black-owned media corporation. And it's family owned, and it's very important into the company bylaws when they set it up and it became big from the magazine stands it initially started out. A blood relative has to run the company at all times. And if not, the Keatons, which is the white family who funded as investors the company, if there's not a living Banks relative, blood relative running the company, the Keatons can take control of it. So with all the ins and outs and ups and downs of this very interesting family, the company is compromised and the Keatons think that it is a good time to strike. However, they don't realize that even though publicly there were only a few Banks heirs and they have either been killed, arrested, like for her, you know, went to prison or otherwise don't want anything to do with the company, that there's all these other heirs out there. So it's like a big game of chess, and we get to see that it's run by the queen, Opal Banks, who her kids are her pawns, her heirs are her pawns, and sometimes pawns have to be sacrificed in order to make it big. And I'm so excited about this character, Opal Banks, because this is one of the first times that I've seen a woman over 70, you know, in a position of power and just with sexiness and just owning as a mogul. And Marianne Alda, she is one of the greatest actresses I know. She's in that role along with Jaylene Mack, who is in the role of Davina. I don't want to give too much of the story away, but when I tell you they have led this this movie to something incredible, and people are going to love it.
Wow. Count it down, baby. Count it down. The premiere is coming. I'm definitely going to keep you posted on this because I'm so proud of her and the work she's done and just being the type of person that's been tangible and willing to help people understand what it means to get in Hollywood. And she did all that, having to direct, having to write. Just keep that in mind. Yeah. Those things are heavy. Mm-hmm. And as people think about trying to get in Hollywood, I want to ask you just a few business questions for those that, like, it's hard for them to wrap their head around the business of Hollywood and how it's evolved. And you've seen this thing a while. You've seen how it's changed over the years. Mm-hmm. And so if you was talking to young Tamieka, I'm going to say 10 years ago, and you're telling her, look, you want to get started in this thing, I can tell you what I've learned from being in the game 10 years. What would you tell that young Tamieka who's starting out at that moment from what you've learned right now, trying to get into Hollywood?
When I tell you your math couldn't be better because I literally moved to LA in June of 2014. So if we were to get 10 years, it would literally be telling myself, June is coming, we're about to go, this is what you need to do. So I just want to tell you how cool that is. So I would say, because I had to learn so much, and I even had to go back and start over. So I moved here in 2014, and then I moved here with two children as a single mother, and they were young at the time. So they were 10 and 4. So by the time my son hit those middle school ages, it got rough, and I didn't see any traction in my career. I realized how hard it is to really just break into this town. So I can really intelligently say, being someone who moved here, had to move back home for a year just to get my feet under me again, and then come back with more knowledge. I can, intelligently say, first of all, nothing is impossible, especially, you know, for people like me who believe in God. There's literally nothing that's impossible. So yes, you can have a career. What it will take is a ton of faith, because you have to be able to see things that your family, your friends, anyone that legitimately loves you does not want you to go to one of the most expensive cities in the world that's 3,000 miles away from everyone you know and love, to not have any job or any leads or any idea of how this is going to happen. So sometimes, you know, we are too hard on what we refer to dream killers or people who don't see the vision. It's not their vision, it's your vision. So you can't really get mad at people for not seeing it. So that's the first thing I would tell myself, like, you know, don't be dismayed or discouraged, or don't give it a second thought for those who don't believe. They're well-meaning, they just care about you. This is your vision, you have to see it through. Be prepared. So have faith, but be prepared. Like me, I literally jumped out on radical faith. I moved here with two kids, two suitcases each that flew free for Southwest, and stayed on a friend of a friend's couch. You know what I mean? With the kids, you know, we got air mattresses. Got them into the best schools. And just started to figure it out, if that meant waiting tables, if that meant doing Postmates or Uber, or that meant having to stay in a motel, like whatever it took for us to physically be here, I did. But, you know, 10 years ago, I would have said, just save up every dime that you can so that I wouldn't have to have it so rough. But I have no regrets. I'm glad I took the leap that I did. And the most important thing that I would tell myself, because this is what changed for me from when I came at 2014 to 2017 with two young kids. So I didn't have, I'm sure everybody's reading the screenwriting books and everybody's following the blogs. They're like, oh, just come get an agent. Do that. Like, it's literally not that easy. Okay, get an agent. How? Where do you meet an agent? And even people who are in those circles, like with a 4-year-old and a 10-year-old, by myself, I really couldn't even go to like the happy hours or the networking events. I had a short window of time to kind of make connections. And that's why connections are so important to me rather than networking. Like, I like a true connection. It can't be transactional. It has to be, a connection. Like, because I couldn't, I never had the opportunity to network. I couldn't. I had to be a mom. That was my most, and remains my most important job. So if I could go to something that's happening in the day, it's important that I really connect with someone and like really, you know, find common ground and ways that we could truly support one another. So I've been very fortunate in that regard. But the biggest thing when you're here in LA, unfortunately, people only see you as valuable and it's only as big as your latest thing or your most current thing. So like how I did QT back in 2020, no one cares. The only reason they care is because they've seen how it has evolved and continues to evolve to something bigger and bigger. But if I would have done that and stopped, it's the most awkward feeling in the world, because as soon as you go to an event in LA, the first thing when people see you, whether they are meeting you for the first time or if they've known you for years, the first thing that you're asked is not even how are you doing, how you been, it's what are you working on? You're only as relevant as what you're doing right now. And that's a lot of pressure. So imagine me from 2014 to 2017, what am I working on? You know, nothing really, you know what I mean? Or being in that aspiring state, which no one really out here respects, you know what I mean? So that's where I was. So the biggest thing I learned from going home was, okay, I jumped the gun by moving here, even though I don't have any regrets, but just realistically, I had no resources and I had no projects. While I was here in 2016, I did start to at least write. I locked myself in my room until I became a screenwriter. And I wrote my first feature. I wrote a couple of pilots. Like, I got that before I left. So then by the time I went back to DC for a year, I came back in 2018 with a plan. I immediately went into production of one of those scripts that I wrote while I was away. And ever since 2018, like I've been, every single year, like I've been working on bigger and bigger projects, and it's made all the difference.
Wow, that's amazing. So then I'll get you on the off ramp with this, because this is one of those subjects where I think every filmmaker runs into it, and that's a lot of creative people don't necessarily come to the table with money. And you talked about one of the ways you can put yourself in a situation, but I don't want to put words in your mouth, so I'll just ask the question.
Yeah.
Filmmakers and creatives, typically, they might have good scripts, they might have decent scripts, whatever, but ultimately, you've got to get them made. Mm-hmm. And if you are a filmmaker, I mean, I don't think there's anyone that can attest to this better than you, because you moved from DC to LA with no connections, hardly. Right. Maybe one or two, one or two. Mm-hmm. And you want to get this stuff made, but you need financing. So talk to the people about, if you're trying to get in a film, how do you go about securing financing? Is that a connections thing? Do you use some of these GoFundMe apps and things that they have nowadays for film? What was your way of getting funding to help you do these great creative projects that you had going?
Great question. And you're so right. And even the idea of connections, you got to realize, especially in an up and coming Hollywood, your connections, they're in the same boat as you. Like, they're trying to raise money as well. So just because you know someone, it doesn't really even automatically always translate into support. And again, that too is okay, because all of us are on our own journey. All of us are doing the best that we can, and we try to support each other how and when we can. But to be specific in terms of the ways that I was able to get things done, first of all, and I highly recommend it. Okay, when God gave me the vision for QT, it wasn't a budget. Use what you have. We're all walking around with like very high-end cameras right on our phones. That's all I had. So I didn't have a budget. I had enough money, and in order to pull it off, I used my personal money. Also, it's bartering and collaborating. Like, sometimes you gotta find like-minded people. Every actor that signed on to QT, they had the identical deal memo, which pretty much said, okay, this is a non-union, unpaid project, but in the event that we ever make a profit, this is the amount that you'll get. And the numbers were different. Now, keep in mind, I didn't even make a profit, but when I did raise the money to do QT Second Shot, the very first thing that I did was settle up all the deal memos and, yeah, make sure everybody, you know, was good. And then some of them I bumped up because I'm like, oh, wow, you took a very low rate and you did a lot of work. You know, we don't have much because we still got to do QT Second Shot, but let me, you know, toss you in a little bit more. So it's about finding, when you have no money, this is plan A, is if you have no money whatsoever, you find like-minded people who will see the vision and collaborate with you. And because guess what? If we don't do anything, we all just sit here. You're an actor. It's in a quarantine. You're doing nothing. I'm a writer and director. I'm in quarantine doing nothing. You know, we can either squabble about pennies and fight about money, or we can do something now. And then if it ever makes money, this is what we'll do. And I was very fortunate enough. And that's why to this day, like, you'll see my same team. Like, we're doing other projects together. And even people who have been on QT, like, I have colleagues in the industry who now are paying attention to them. And, hey, you know, can you grab this person for my project? Can you make that connection? Absolutely. So they've gotten other jobs just by being obedient and not thinking about money up front. It's come to other opportunities for them to get cast for other things. So that's the first thing. Use what you have and collaborate. So you don't have cameras or you don't have money, use your phone, find some people that's willing to do it, boom. Guess what? Now, we did that with QT. QT is now on Tubi, and every single month, and this is since 2020 when I did this project, it's been on Tubi since like 2021. Every single, there's not a month that goes by that I don't get some kind of check. And it may be a very small one or maybe a very big one. Like, it just depends on what the streams are. But that is something we did with virtually no money. And the money that I did, I had to pay the editor, of course, because that's going to be the hardest thing in the world to try to get someone to do for free and understandable. But, you know, I paid the editor. And, yeah, so we now have something that we can get distribution for with our iPhones. And now it's a bigger platform for us. People all over the world are watching it and somehow finding it. And that's super exciting. So that's what I would say in terms of if you have nothing, there's still no excuse. You have an iPhone, you have somebody that has a phone, an Android, anything. It's a camera, it's a video, you can do it. Plan B, tap into your personal network. We had a huge success with crowdfunding using GoFundMe, but there's several other platforms. There's really no magic platform. All of them are going to give you a place where they can take payments, and they're going to take a portion of it. And it's up to you to hit the ground. You have to swallow every bit of pride that you had. And I am thankful for being an independent filmmaker because it's changed my relationship with asking for money, because I don't look at it the same. Like, as a single mother, I will struggle. I will make a meal of Frosted Flakes and homemade biscuits and like make you the most gourmet breakfast that you ever had, knowing I don't have a dime to my name before I would ask anyone, hey, can you help me feed my kids? You know what I mean? Like, but filmmaking, you got to realize you're not, when I like took the lead in the crowdfunding, I had an amazing crowdfunding manager, Shakisha Williams, who helped me come up with strategies, but it still was on me to be the face of it and to talk to everyone. Like, I knocked on every door. Like, you have to set aside all pride, but there really should be none, because it's not like I am asking you to feed my family. I am asking you to help me create something that is bigger than all of us. So you're going to go to Starbucks, you're going to go to you know, Cheesecake Factory, you know, you're going to do those things and you will spend some kind of money at some point. You can take that same amount, and if enough of us give that same amount, we can actually create something that's going to be bigger than all of us. And right. That's what you had. I had to learn to do. And I love my team so much. You know what I mean? Like, I need them. Oh, I apologize. I love my team. I love my team so much that I want them to win. And I will, you know, so it's not exactly something that I even think twice about. Like, hey, if we're successful at this, well, when we're successful at this, we're going to have these opportunities to create stories, create jobs, create other opportunities for them to get noticed. So, yeah, how could I not ask everybody? I mean, without crowdfunding, I was calling up people that I went to church with as a little girl and haven't talked to in years, like just and asking, can you help us? You know what I mean? Can you support us? So, and then lastly, that leads me to my current situation, because the cool thing about being a filmmaker, one thing get out of your mind that people don't want to support you. And definitely we got to stop saying that in terms of Black people don't support one another, because far overwhelming majority of my supporters were people of color, Black specifically. And we raised over 40K in 40 days. We met our goal. The following year, we raised another 30K. And then from there, when you create that, but you have to be supportable. When you're asking for support, you got to be supportable. Like, and you also got to be supportive. Like, people will support you if you support them. It's very simple. That's the problem. Half the time, people want support, but they don't support others. You know what I mean? Or they want to support. They want people to support something that has not really been fleshed out well. So with that being said, every time I did something, every time I did QT, because I did QT even with the cell phone, most people could resonate with that and say, oh, wow, let me help her do the next thing. So then when I did QT second shot, I no longer had to, I mean, so I was able to easily get people to support me because they can see, oh, this is the type of stuff that she does. Cool, let's get behind her. So then once I did QT second shot, I no longer had to crowdfund. I was able to just get investors, but it's the same dynamics. Instead of me going to 600 people, you know, asking for, you know, a certain amount of money to reach 40K, like whatever everybody can give, now it's 10 or 15 people, like, hey, can I have a specific amount of money? Because the budget is obviously way bigger once we have bigger names and brand locations and travel arrangements for our actors to come in and all these things. So those are the ways that you can, as an independent filmmaker, like, you can raise money, but you got to do the work.
Wow. So ladies and gentlemen, did you hear all that? She basically said you can get it done.
You can.
She's basically saying that no matter how hard you've heard it's been, no matter what the mind is trying to tell you to psych you from achieving your dream, she's saying that you can get it done. And a lot of what she said is because Hollywood is so much of a team sport.
Yeah.
And different people are at different places and people will want to collaborate with you. You don't need as much money. You can collaborate on what you have and your skills, and you can put together something beautiful, just like she did with Spawns. And for that, Miss Mika, you get the Hollywood standing ovation. You got to get it. Sit tight. I might not look like Spike Lee, but damn it, I can clap like him.
You sure can. And you look like you, which is outstanding, bro.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, that is the first interview in many on how to make it in Hollywood as a Black creative. I want to thank Tamieka so much. She's been an inspiration to not just me, like I said, Taylor Todd, and many others. Y'all just are familiar with T-Streams. She's helped so many. She's helped herself. And now she's really starting to get the fruits of her labor coming through. If you want to follow this young woman, her link is in video description. Her website's in video description. Make sure you click down there to see QTs, all of them. They're all good. They're all entertaining. That little clip that I showed you is only it was only 40 seconds. Go get the whole thing. In closing, Ms. Briscoe, is there anything you want to say to the audience before we get you out of here? And thank you for your time.
Thank you for having me, and thank you for watching is what I'd love to say to the audience. And just even if it's not film, whatever your thing is, have faith. Those same principles that I spoke about with my film journey apply. Have faith, work hard, look to your left, look to your right, show up to serve, and don't be afraid to ask for help. Like, we're all in this together. And we don't have to play small, but if you want to play small, even do that to the best of your ability. But life is meant to be happy, and do whatever it is that you're passionate about, and use your gifts, like, because your gifts, they're not only for you, they're tied to, like, I could have been home in DC living very comfortable, but because I chose to even struggle to come to LA, look how many opportunities have been opened up to so many people who I care about. And, you know, look how my path even crossed to meet yours, Lamont. That wouldn't have happened if, you know, I did not take a step on faith. And I'm happy, my kids are happy, and nothing in society can hold you back. Not your race, not your gender, not having kids out of wedlock, like nothing. Like, you just gotta keep pushing forward. You may have to maneuver differently, but whatever your thing is, like, go hard with it, and like, you'll make it.
Uh-oh, do I need to go get my Bible? Where my Bible at? Boy, she went and told a sermon, ladies and gentlemen. Let me get that collection plate in here, giving the word to y'all today. Hey, y'all, yeah. Know you were going to get all that, did you? But she said, have faith, y'all. Keep it going. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that is going to do it. Please follow this sister. Don't forget to like the video. You can always follow me on El Twitter. Please download the podcast. I will link this interview on the podcast. And go over there and check me out on TikTok. I am now almost at 10,000 followers on TikTok. Yes, that is my baby dressed as Wonder Woman. You get all the stuff with me and the lovely ladies of Life Gang. Go check us out. Tamieka, it's been an honor. Grateful for not only your mentorship, but your friendship and your help and everything you've done to just help us out in this Hollywood conundrum. You've made it less of a conundrum. Ladies and gentlemen, till that next Sexy as Hell video, click her links. We're out. Yeah.